Judgment.
You still play that?
What?
You still play that?
Eh, on occasion. I figured yesterday when I was trying it out, I was like, eh, why not? I haven't played Demon Souls in quite a while. Why not? Why not? For the old sake of Mordoing, people.
You haven't beat it?
Oh, beat it? Yeah, I've beaten it like 5 times.
So what else? Oh, so they're just replaying it again?
Mordoing, people. PvP, man.
Just for fun?
Oh, I don't know why else you would do PvP. I mean, if you would hope people would do PvP for fun. But then again, I guess you can never know.
I didn't know that game had anything like that. I haven't really played it or looked into it much.
You didn't know any of the Souls games had PvP in them?
No. I hardly ever look into those games. They don't really interest me.
Oh, that's a shame. Well, if you're ever interested, feel free to give me a call. Definitely help. Pixie's really liking Bloodborne right now, so... Yeah. But... Eh, everyone has their own tastes, so... Okay, I got the recording going and stuff, so... What would you like to start on talking about? What do you think's a good stepping stone?
I don't know, you haven't watched much of Nintendo's.
Yeah, not a lot of people talked about. Like, most of what I got was from people who made videos. Because, you know, most of the conferences are about an hour long and that, and most people, you know, have condensed information in 10 minutes. And I think Louis Pogeo was, like, the only person who made one for Nintendo, and he was just, like, boring. Pixie told me they mostly just recapped on stuff that they already announced.
Yeah. I mean, there was a lot of new 3DS stuff, but... I don't know. A lot of it was kind of boring.
I mean...
But... The Shin Megami Tensei Cross Fire Emblem stuff was good.
Yeah, I always consider Fire Emblem good. I heard they changed if to, like, what, Destiny or Fate or something?
Yeah, that's Fates. And I guess we are getting two versions of that game. Originally, I think someone said that they were going to take both the versions that Japan was getting and put it into one game here when localizing it, but I guess we are getting two versions.
You know, that'd be kind of stupid to do that, but eh. But I do think I recall someone saying they also explained what the two versions would be for.
But well, one's harder and one's easier, and then one is the Nor side and one's the Hoshido or whatever.
That's it?
Yeah. Well, I mean, the stories are different from each side.
Oh, really?
I guess you can say one's the dark side
so
and one's
the
light
side.
They're
completely different stories than...
Yeah.
Well, I didn't even know that.
And I believe if you get both versions, I think I heard this, and I think it could have been a rumor, but I don't remember. It was a while back that if you got both versions of the game, you get, like, a free DLC that's essentially a third game, but, I mean, it's just DLC, but it just, I don't know. I mean, the people made it sound like it was a third game, like a third story, basically. Something that happens in between the two, but I can't remember. It was only if you got both the versions, though. I don't really like that they're turning it into a Pokemon kind of thing, though. Like that.
Yeah, that is an odd thing for them to do, in my opinion. I mean, when they first announced it, because, I mean, like, it, you know, if it was something to do with Pokemon, it makes sense. But, you know, with the Shimotensei series, it's like, what's that even have anything to do with it?
Oh, are we talking about Shin Megami Tensei Cross Fire Emblem, or are we talking about Shin Megami, Fire Emblem, just a Fire Emblem 3DS games.
Oh, I thought it was the Shimotensei one that was having two versions.
No, it's only having one. The
So the Shin
Fire
Tensei
Emblem.
one's having one, and the actual Fire Emblem game is having two. Oh,
Yeah,
well,
because you
now it
said
makes even less sense to me.
you said that it had gotten a new subtitle. Fire Emblem had gotten a new subtitle. I mentioned it was Fates, and then that's when I went on to the saying that it does have two versions now. So Fire Emblem Fates will have two versions and two separate stories.
Oh shit, now that makes. I don't know what we say about that. That's just.
The Shin Megami Tensei Cross Fire Emblem stuff, we did get more info on. That is only obviously one game. They did give it a new name, but it's still Japanese. I don't even remember what it's called because it's Japanese. But so it still has to get an official name, so I'm just gonna refer to it as still Shin Megami Tensei Cross Fire Emblem. But they showed that there are Fire Emblem characters in the game now. I think we already knew about the tiki girl, the green hair girl being in there, but there's a like a store, like an employee behind, like in the shop, like I guess it's called the Hee Haw shop, and it's got the Jack Frost logo on the top of it. And when you go in there, Anna from Fire Emblem Awakening is just the shop employee, like the cashier there from Fire Emblem. So it seems like there's just going to be little hints of Fire Emblem characters like that, which is kind of weird. I mean, it's not really using them in any special way.
See, I haven't gotten to play a lot of the model and Fire Emblem games, so I'm kind of out of the loop on some of the characters.
Yeah. You didn't play Awakening?
I have it, but I haven't really got to play it. That's my
No.
sad cursed fate to get 5 million games and only time to play two.
Yeah.
Maybe one
But
day when
I'm
I
sure
get
you
more.
can understand. I mean, just imagine just taking
Oh
a
yeah,
character
I'm just
and just
saying
sticking them in there.
I don't personally know all the modern characters very well is basically what I'm
Yeah.
saying. But yeah, I like the character, like when you're doing references, I like to usually have them have a lot more meaning. I mean, sometimes a skill reference is okay, but it kind of depends on how you're doing it.
Yeah. And I guess Shin Megami Tensei Cross Fire Emblem, as if it didn't seem like Persona enough, it's way more like Persona than I even thought it was. Each character has like a Fire Emblem, like, I guess you can say Persona. It's not a Persona, obviously, because this is not a Persona game, but they, like, for instance, the blue hair guy, Itsuki, I think that's his name. He has Crom, which I would assume you know who Crom is from Fire Emblem Awakening. You might not, but
I think
he
I
was a
heard
common
about him.
character. Yeah, he's in Smash as well as an assist for Robin. I mean, not assist, it's Final Smash for Robin.
Yeah, I've seen him.
Yeah, he unfortunately didn't make it into Smash, but he is basically a persona, not really, but like a persona for the main character, the main protagonist of Shin Megami Tensei Cross Fire Emblem. And there's more character, like for each other character and the cast of characters in Shin Megami Tensei Cross Fire Emblem all have a Fire Emblem, again, persona kind of thing. Which obviously they look darker and they don't look exactly like they do from the video game.
So
But,
they decided to take previous characters and make them personas, like weird, like what if they were personas?
basically, and they gave them a pretty dark look too. And like for instance, Crom, he kind of has this sound as if he's wearing armor because he kind of has that sound like he's talking through armor, despite the fact that he's just wearing a scarf, I think, over his mouth. I don't know. He has a weird voice. And then the game obviously has a heavy, like, J-pop thing going on, and that's like a lot of what the game is about. It's about like the idol thing. Like one, the red hair character wants to be an actor, I guess, or something. And the other girl character that's been shown on the Pegasus Knight, wants to be a singer, like an idol as well. So, and they have like this, I forget what they call it, what they called it, because I only watched the little gameplay once this morning. It almost seems like in a Persona game where they had a, like, where they would get their persona once admitting, you know, that was them. It seems like they have to unlock theirs as well by, I don't even know what they're doing, but they have like this little, that little shiny ball orb thing you saw in the first trailer of Shin Megami Tensei Cross Fire Emblem.
Yeah.
Something related to their persona type characters. And then somehow they have to get that. I didn't understand it very well, but it has, the whole game is just based on idols and music. It's really weird. The gameplay is a mixture of Shin Megami Tensei and Fire Emblem, though. It still has all the weaknesses of all the skills. All the skill moves are still Shin Megami Tensei, you know, like the fire, ice, wind, or force, I guess. At least that's what Shin Megami Tensei called it. They still have those for skill attacks. And then the standard regular, like, sword attacks, just the regular equipment attacks, are Fire Emblem. So I think now, you know, like the axe, lance, and sword, and they have like a little weakness to each one.
Yeah.
So it has that. So it does look interesting. It looks pretty good, but I don't know. They don't have any Shin Megami Tensei in there from what I could tell, other than some of the gameplay. There's no Shin Megami Tensei characters whatsoever.
Huh. So what, they just wanted to do the dark, moody kind of thing?
Yeah, I don't know. It's weird.
I guess for
it's
anyone,
dark enough.
I guess people hoping for a weird crossover are gonna be disappointed.
Yeah, I think none of the Shin Megami Tensei fans like it, and none of the Fire Emblem fans have liked it yet. So I feel like I'm the only one that does.
I won't know until I get to play it.
You can, I think later tonight, or tomorrow, Nintendo should have their Nintendo, like, the Treehouse Live, posted on their YouTube channel, and it's the first thing they showed this morning, so if you just watch day two of, Treehouse Live, the first thing they'll show is Shin Megami Tensei Cross Fire Emblem, and they cover, like, 40 minutes of gameplay. They showed dungeons, which look just like Persona dungeons. They even have shadow things roaming the dungeons, and you can attack them to stun them and walk up to them and get first attack and all that. It's very similar. They show a whole 40 minutes of it, so they cover a lot of stuff if you want to see the gameplay of it.
Okay, I'll check that out. And we're talking about the Fire Emblem games at the moment. I'm assuming
Shin Megami Tensei Cross Fire Emblem.
Yeah, I was going to say, I'm assuming you can see the chat room too, right?
Oh. No, because I turned off my Xbox just to get...
Oh,
just
okay.
So that way I wouldn't running two things at once.
Okay. Got one with a summon in it. Okay. Well, he just said it. Yes, he did just say it. But, I'm going to have to book it down this pathway. Oh, he got lag backstab. But, yeah, that's what we're talking about at the moment. Is there anything else you want to add on that?
Not much. I mean, and you haven't watched the...
Yeah.
You haven't seen much of it yet, so...
Yeah, I mean, from what I heard from the few people, they just really went over stuff that people already knew was going to come out.
Yeah, for the most part. I mean, other than the 3DS games. The only actual interesting game I thought was in Nintendo's digital event, aside from Shin Megami Tensei Cross Fire Emblem, things we already knew about, was the Mario and Luigi Paper Jam, the crossover.
Yeah, I did hear
Paper
about
Mario.
That. Like, it's supposed to have Paper Mario with Mario and Luigi.
Yeah, it's interesting, but they It's got the gameplay of the Mario and Luigi games, and basically Paper Mario is just in there. But the worlds, like the, it seems to take a lot from Sticker Star, based like on the worlds. Like it's still very generic. It still seems like it deals with a lot of toads instead of actual interesting characters. Like the thing I like about Paper Mario games is they always had really interesting characters that you never really see in the Mario universe, because no other games go that in depth into the, you know, Mario world. So that's the one thing I've always liked about Paper Mario, but Sticker Star got rid of that, and it seems like this is not going to fix it. It seems like it's still going to be generic characters, just toads and basic grassy lands and stuff like that. The gameplay is basically the same as Mario and Luigi, but with a couple Paper Mario gimmicks and gimmicks for having a third character instead of just Mario and Luigi. And then they have that weird papercraft thing where, like, you do, like, this toad minigame to hype up all the toads, and the toads start carrying the big papercraft Mario, and you just start destroying Goomba, like, big papercraft Goombas. I don't even know what the point in that is, but I assume it's some kind of boss thing or something at some point. Other than that, they didn't show much of that. So it seems like it's still really early in development and doesn't even come out till 2016, so.
Ooh. I haven't played the Sticker Star one, but I've played the other Paper Mario games, and I heard a lot of people say Sticker Star was really disappointing, so if it's very similar to Sticker Star, I don't think a lot of people are going to be happy with it then.
Gameplay-wise, I think it may be in story. It seems, well, I mean, if it's going to be Paper Mario and Mario and Luigi, it's probably it's obviously the story is going to be a mixture of both, but gameplay-wise, it seems like Mario and Luigi. So I think it's going to be a fun game to play, but I don't know that it'll be that interesting, and I don't know that the worlds will be that fun, because Mario and Luigi games have had pretty fun worlds, but Sticker Stars were really generic, and all the characters in the game were very generic. So it had some good humor, like most of the Paper Mario games, but other than that, it wasn't that great. So hopefully it doesn't take too much from Sticker Star, but I think it'll still be a fun game. So
he was hoping it's some decent then. So unless there's something else about Nintendo you want to talk about, you want to go to a different one?
Yeah, we can move on to something else. We can go back to Nintendo later.
Okay. Now, who would you want to start with?
What do you mean? Like Microsoft or Sony or game-wise?
Either one. Whichever particular topic you feel like talking about.
Well, what have you seen? So it's something that you...
The only things I got to see was the Elder Scrolls People's thing on Sunday and the Sony one.
Yeah, Bethesda?
Yeah.
Okay.
I got to see those.
But you didn't see Microsoft's?
No. I didn't get to see Microsoft's. And Sony's only got half of it.
I don't know much about Shenmue, but what do you think about the Shenmue 3 and the fact that Sony is actually paying for it now?
Well, I'm solely unless did they actually officially say they will?
Yeah, I don't know how they are considering they don't have much money, but I wonder if it's going to turn out that great because of that.
I'm definitely excited for Shenmue 3, and I would think Sony has some money in it. But I don't know about them saying I didn't hear anything about them saying they had no money, you know?
But just recently, they said that, they took the Kickstarter down, and it was essentially just a way of building hype for it to see how much people actually cared about it. And then they took the Kickstarter off, and now they're funding it.
Whoa. So the Kickstarter was dead now? What?
Yeah, I that's what I heard, unless that was just
because I checked it like 30 minutes ago, and it was still up, so I'll
it is?
Check,
like, I don't know, maybe it is.
Like, I'll have to check on that.
I thought and either they took it down or it's just irrelevant at this point, and it's still up, but I don't know, maybe they're not using it.
I'm gonna have to look
I'm not
into
really
that
sure.
after this. I'm curious, because I want my physical copy, damn it. I mean, if Sony makes it, sure, I'm happy then, but I want my damn physical copy.
Well, I actually think it's better if Sony's doing it because I think Sony will do a physical copy. I don't think we're only getting a PC physical copy, right? I think we'll get a PS4 physical copy, obviously, if Sony's doing it. If
Yeah,
they're paying for
that's
it.
what it was though.
Yeah, so I would rather Sony do it because I do want a PlayStation 4 physical copy over a
Oh
PC.
yeah, I'd rather have a PS4 version, definitely. Don't get me wrong though. It's just
Yeah.
were they actually, but I'm very excited to I mean, I played Shenmue 1 back on the Dreamcast, and I played Shenmue 2 on the original Xbox, because the only way you could do it back then was to import it on the Dreamcast if you wanted to keep playing on a Dreamcast. But so for America, you had to do it on the original Xbox, and I mean, I know they're not everyone's cup of tea. I mean, it's a very story-driven game with Virtua Fighter's kind of engine being used for the fighting. And it was like considered one of the early games to use QTEs. Obviously, it wasn't the first one. Most people quit Dragon's Lair being the first one, but Shenmue was one of the early titles that also used QTEs. So I mean, it's definitely not some kind of hardcore gritty game or anything, but it was a story game that a lot of people got invested in, and I mean, being truthful, both Shenmue games were unprofitable. They costed more money than they made back, which is one of the reasons Shenmue 3 never got greenlit for so long. And then another reason is the kind of technology they used was like something that's commonplace now in video games. But back then, having like all this crap attached to you for moving and stuff, and there was just a lot of stuff they used that was not commonplace in video games back then. So I would think all that stuff's vastly cheaper now, I would think. So I think it would work a lot better right now, considering, I mean, that's all theoretical. I mean, I don't know by heart, but I have a good feeling in those sections that made the original Shenmue games cost a lot. I think it won't be as bad. I'm really excited on it because the Cradle, he came up with the whole thing as a trilogy, so theoretically this should be the last game. So this is, the conclusion, the end. Why was Shenmue's father immortal? Why is this mural piece that the Mordor took so important? What's really in China and everything? Now, a lot of people really hyped about the conclusion, but since it's a story-driven game, I'm probably not too concerned about whether we'll live up to it much, because it's going to be more about story than it's gameplay, because it doesn't have like a huge combat system and stuff, so I mean that's all secondary stuff, so I'm not too concerned about that overall. But being a Kickstarter, I was concerned about, obviously the normal worries of a Kickstarter, where they mismanage money and stuff like that, where they end up like Tim Schafer's studio, where they just fucked up what they were doing with money, or have drama and shit, or like what happened with Mighty No. 9.
Yeah.
Ugh. I don't want that ever happening to anything I kickstart again. Ugh. But
Yeah, I'm kind of curious on I think Shenmue 3 will do good in Japan. I mean, if Yakuza's still doing good. I heard Yakuza 0 still sold really well in Japan. I don't know if it's gonna sell well here though, 'cause Yakuza games don't sell that well here.
Those are similar. I heard the last few ones Sega was kind of happy with, but when they initially, yeah, the PS2 ones and that, they sold very bad. But from what I heard from Sega, they at least been happy with the more modern ones, which is
Yeah,
good. Cause, go ahead.
they haven't released Yakuza 5 on the PSN yet, right? I don't think they have.
I
I haven't
don't
heard about
know,
it.
but I do remember DSP saying, "Oh, I'm gonna play this or that or something." Holy shit, that guy one shot at me. These are high level dudes. Well, not high level, but they have. Damn.
Yeah, I've never played the Shenmue games. How similar are those to the Yakuza games? Because I've only played Yakuza.
But Yakuza is more of a beat 'em up style with the story social aspect of Shenmue. So, it's a lot more action oriented than Yakuza. So there's a lot more gameplay in Yakuza. Take out a lot of the fighting and I mean, they're like Shenmue 1 maybe had like 4 times where you actually fought people. I mean it's a lot of wandering around, talking to people, and trying to figure out what to do and where you're going and stuff. The answer to the chat room question of what happened with Mighty No. 9, their PR person that got assigned as a community PR, she was absolutely insane. Like, she was pushing her agenda into the project, possibly not doing her job properly in communication between the developers and the community, and then she started basically banhammering backers and shit. I remember there was like a backer who gave them like $10,000, and he like got an Amazon refund or PayPal refund and got his money back. Because she banned him. Like, he was a $10,000 backer and he got banned. Like, could you imagine throwing $10,000 at Kickstarter and then you get banned from interacting with it at all? On the Twitter, on the forums, on the Kickstarter page? Like, that's fucking crazy. It's like, just for their opinion. Like, that was a PR nightmare. And then she, like the day before she got fired on Twitter, she said something about all Gamergate people should be burned to death or something. Then next day she got fired. So, like, the Mighty No. 9 Kickstarter has not talked about or acknowledged anything about what she did or anything, which is kind of bad in itself too, because to be honest, some of those backers I think they need to apologize to. And also, those people are still blocked too. Like, those people said they're still blocked, so they haven't fixed what she fucked up either, so kind of a mess there. I can understand weird cheapo people maybe, but like people throwing big monies your way, that's kind of shitty to be treating them like crap. I mean, wouldn't you agree? There?
Oh yeah, I was doing something. Yeah.
But I mean, it was really just a PR issue with the community manager person they picked. I don't know what the fuck her problem was. She was just crazy, so. But she's gone and that, so. But that kind of thing is the kind of thing I would never hope any Kickstarter ever happens again. Like when it comes to Kickstarter, Yacht Club to me is like the only Kickstarter game that went really well. No drama, no stupid shit, no mismanaged money. They made the game, at least it was critical success. I don't think I've ever heard anyone say anything about hating Shovel Knight. So, pretty much every other Kickstarter I've ever had anything to do with has had something, even if minor. Do you kickstart anything?
No, I haven't done it yet. There's been multiple games I've wanted to, but I've just never gotten around to it. I wanted to do Yooka-Laylee, but I just never got around to it.
Yeah. It can be risky stuff. I mean, like I tell viewers on my channel, if you kickstart something, consider the money gone. Don't, like, because you might not ever see anything come back from it. And that sucks, but that's the risk of trying to back something that normal publishers probably were never okay anyway.
Yeah. Did you back the ukulele or even the Bloodstained?
I did the Bloodstained. Ukulele, I wasn't too interested in. I mean, I'm happy for people who like Banjo-Kazooie, but I mean, I'm not a big platformer person. Like, some of the ones I hate the most is like the most of the Donkey Kong Country. The Donkey Kong countries that force you to collect shit, those are the ones I hate. Like, you need to collect Donkey Kong to progress. You need to collect all these colored bananas to progress. Like, I hate that. And I'm not trying to be mean to anyone who likes those. I mean, it's just not my cup of tea. Nothing mean of that. But it's
Yeah, that's what makes
awesome.
them challenging.
That's fine. I just find it annoying in my personal opinion that I would say the Donkey Kong thing was probably more challenging where you collected and had to find the letters. I found the banana thing really annoying though in the N64 game.
The
But
N64, or the Donkey Kong 64 was one of the easiest Donkey Kong games in my opinion. I think the Donkey Kong co original Donkey Kong Country games on the Super NES were actually harder.
now,
The
I
side-scrolling.
didn't play much of the N64 title though. I only played a little of it, and I didn't like the collecting. In generally, I don't like games that force you to collect things usually. I do have a strong tendency to not like a lot of games like that. But I'm not a big
I've
play.
always liked that.
And there's nothing wrong with that. I mean, like, I like the Souls games. Well, technically, you could even make the same argument. Well, you collect shit to find out story bits on items. I mean, you could make that argument with the Souls game. So, I don't know. I'm not a big platformer on that. And, like, I did play the first Banjo-Kazooie, and I did enjoy it, but I sucked really bad at it, though. It was like DSP levels of suckage. But of course, that was also a really long time ago. But I suck at platforming, so but it is awesome for the fan base of platform, because I know Banjo-Kazooie is held in high regard in the platforming community as like one of the best series for platforming. So don't get me wrong, I think it's definitely exciting for them with it. But I didn't bother with it. Maybe one day I'll pick it up, especially since they recently announced that it's going to be on GOG, so that's a better incentive for me. Bloodstain, I definitely backed Bloodstain because I love the Metroidvania kind of style of Castlevania games, even though storylines have varied. I think it's nice that the Cradle is going to actually start have just a whole new storyline to start with, because I've definitely have been a big critic of what he's done with the Castlevania storyline. I've been a very big critic of what he's done with the storylines a lot, especially in Course of Darkness. So I think it'll be refreshing for him to have a whole new storyline. He can just start from the beginning, but kind of wheeling away from E3 heel.
I know, I was just going to mention that. Well, since we were just talking about platformers and stuff, which, you know, Banjo-Kazooie and things like that, and ukulele, what do you think about the Rareware collection thing
that
they had,
was,
the Rare
that was probably
replay?
The only thing I was actually interested in.
Yeah, because Conker is in that collection. That's an expensive game.
Yeah, that in my opinion is probably the only reason to be really excited. I mean, it's really nice at the same time, but yeah, Bad 4 Day is very expensive, and I mean, most of the other games are very cheap. I mean, the Perfect Dark games, even though the first ones regarded really high, I mean, none of them are really valuable games, so.
Yeah. Is Battletoads a little more? I mean, it's not, I don't think it's expensive, but is it a little bit pricier than most of them? Because that's included in the question as well.
I don't know how much.
I
don't
know
how much. Sorry, I'm trying to help this one guy because I already murdered them once, so I'm trying to be nice to them. But, I don't know how much the Battletoad games are nowadays, so I'm not really sure.
Yeah. I was actually a little disappointed that they only put Bad Fur Day in the collection, and they didn't put Live and Reloaded in there, or at least an option to you do the Live and Reloaded, because
yeah,
I like the graphics
because there was,
of that
there
game.
There was also new content in it, so.
Yeah. I mean, there was a downside, the fact that there was some censorship in that game, but
yeah.
I mean, I would like to play, you know, both Bad Fur Day and Live and Reloaded for, you know, the different reasons, uncensored version and then the other version for the better graphics and extra stuff. So it's a little disappointing they didn't add that. I'm kind of surprised they put Grab by the Ghoulies in there. I mean, it makes sense since it's a Rareware game, but
yeah,
that game wasn't very good. At least not in my opinion.
I never played Grab by the Ghoulies, ironically. It's something I've tried to get before, but I've never actually.
Not very many
it.
People liked it, did they?
I never heard any real good stuff, and somebody in the chat room says that Battletoads versus Double Dragon, I'm assuming, is what they're referring to with DD, or is it more on the expensive side? So,
oh, the Game Boy game.
He doesn't say which version. So, I mean, you got Game Boy, the NES, Super Nintendo. So, I mean, those different versions of them. That so.
Well, I believe Battletoads versus the Double Dragon is on the Game Boy, unless there was a Super NES version. I don't know about our NES version.
I know there was Battletoads on the Super Nintendo. I'm not sure about Double Dragons.
I guess we should move on to something else, like, how about Final Fantasy VII? What did you think of that? And you said you had something to say about that, didn't you, before we
yeah,
started this?
Yeah, I have some mixed feelings on VII. It's really just a mixed bag. I mean, if they actually legitimately do just a straight-out remake with, you know, obviously fixing, like, magic defense was worthless in the original game because it was actually broken. It didn't work properly. So any armor that had magic defense or focused on magic defense was worthless because it didn't work. So, I mean, obviously fix those kind of things. But, I mean, in general, if it just remains pretty true, but, you know, it's upgraded and that, I'll be happy with that. But what I'm concerned about is, like, recently in an article, some interview from one of the journalist sites, they were saying something about wanting to add or change some story elements. And See, like, a lot of people made a lot of the original Final Fantasies from the beginning to like around 9-ish. A lot of those people are gone. They've left or went on to other businesses or their own companies and stuff. Genesis and Super Nintendo versions are what I was talking about. Okay. That's what he was referring to with his comment.
Okay.
So you got people who have you got a team of people who basically had nothing to do with Final Fantasy VII, and I'm slightly concerned whether they'll be like they'll interpret certain scenes or things and be like, oh, I should inject it this way or something, and like I'm just worried about them retconning and changing certain things, And then the artistic style is another concern that I'm worried about. Like,
Well, from the trailer, it looked pretty nice. I mean, from what you can see
yeah.
in the trailer,
You
I liked
barely
it.
get to see Cloud, but it did look like he was in his purple jumpsuit with the shoulder pad, so it looks like that part probably won't be as bad of a concern. But I was telling Pixie when he first said something and I had not seen it. Like, I was like, I swear if it's Cloud wearing the movie outfit he was wearing in the movie, I'm just gonna walk away, because, like, I don't want to see everyone look different. I mean, I don't want them,
Yeah,
like.
I didn't really like the looks of them in the movie either,
Well, it's not that, like,
compared
in the
to their
movie it's
form.
fine because times changed and people's taste and things changed, but I hate when people, like, change, like, if they ever do some enhanced remake of something and they fucking change everything and it's, like, I can't think of a good example off the top of my head. It's just, if everyone artistically just looks like upgraded versions of what they war and stuff in the Final Fantasy VII, I'll be happy in that front. But I mean, if everyone's wearing vastly different outfits and shit, like, it's gonna bother me. It's gonna be odd to me. I mean, maybe you could say I'm nitpicking, but it those are
No,
the two.
I wouldn't mind if there was alternate outfits that you can equip,
Yeah,
or even ones
that I
based off the
wouldn't
movie.
mind, but I mean, and I doubt they're gonna do that, but if they do that, it's actually cool. That would be cool if they actually did that. Have no
Well, with
problem with that.
Square, they'll probably make it a pre-order item exclusive to GameStop or something.
Oh, deal. All the fan service outfits for Tifa. Oh, dear
Yeah.
Lord.
I'll pre-order at three places.
Well, at least we know who to blame for the idea if they actually do it.
Yeah, I wouldn't mind if there's some extra stuff, as if it's just like things that happen after Final
Oh
Fantasy. I
yeah,
don't
I
really want them
mean,
to edit it, but I don't mind
the thing I'd
things
like
that.
them to actually do probably the most would be to actually like explain something in the ending.
Yeah.
Because I mean, they don't. I mean, I get the ending wasn't really meant to actually really do anything, but at the time, they didn't. They never even planned on having sequels, so.
Yeah.
Like a dual wielder here. But now that there have actually been sequels, so I know GameStop they would make a original outfit for the pre-order bonus. Yeah, that's what GameStop likes doing.
What if they somehow got lightning into the game?
Well, that'd be odd. But then again, I can't say I would be surprised much by it. I mean, look at Final
Try
Fantasy
and get
X.
her more popular.
That one guy who's behind Final Fantasy 13 has a hard-on for lightning, that's for sure. That guy is obsessed with lightning. I don't know why he's so obsessed with her, but I mean that's fine if he's like all waifu overhaul. I mean nothing, not trying to judge here, but I don't mind them adding new content. I just don't want them to fuck around with the pre-existing content, if you get what I mean. Like outfits that you can change in and out to, I can be fine with that. But like if you can't and you know they have only one outfit and they change them all, like I don't know, it would just seem weird to me if Cloud wasn't in his purple jumpsuit. Like it just
Yeah,
would be,
wouldn't
I mean, I can understand there's probably going to be more detailed belts and stuff all over it. Square Enix and their 5 million belts on outfits, but I just, I don't know, I'm just in a very mixed feeling spot with it. I'm excited for it, but at the same time, I'm kind of dreading that I'm going to absolutely hate it because it's going to stomp on everything I liked. If it doesn't, then, you know, that'll be awesome then. But if it does, then, well, I'll be upset. I mean, do you have anything you might be slightly concerned about with it?
like I've said, I've never actually played the game. I've
Oh
just never
yeah, I
gotten
forgot
around to
you
it.
did say that.
Yeah, a while back. I've just never actually got around to playing the game. I've watched playthroughs before on YouTube, so I know how it is. You know, I know the story,
Yeah.
and I've seen the movie, but yeah, I also hope they don't change the gameplay to be more like the Final Fantasy 15, because that doesn't look very fun. I
Yeah,
don't like that. I like the
and that's another
turn-based.
thing. Yeah, I don't. They say remake, but again, that kind of goes in the same thing. I'm concerned about them changing shit. Like, if they make it like Crisis Core action or like an MMO or something. Like, I want it to be a turn-based game. I don't want them to change what the hell it was.
Yeah, it seems like they're doing that with Final Fantasy 15 to try and pull in that Kingdom Hearts crowd, the more casual crowd, I guess.
I haven't played the Realms Reborn. Oh wait, you said 15. I have a brain fart. Ugh. I haven't actually played the demo that I got with Type Zero. I need to actually do that.
It got a 2.0 update, right? So it's got new content.
The demo?
Yeah, they got like an update called 2.0 or something, and
Really?
they got some extra stuff.
I didn't even know that. Oh,
Yeah, I don't
that's.
have the demo, but I just heard about it.
You didn't get Type Zero?
No, not yet. I might get it since the price has dropped a couple times, so.
Well, if you can find a Day One edition, you can get the demo. It's only in the Day One editions.
Yeah, I could probably find one somewhere. I don't think that's sold out everywhere, I'm sure.
It depends on how well it's sold. I don't know how well Type Zero is sold, so, or how many.
Unless there was an expiration date on the demo.
I would have to look.
Anything else you want to talk about from E3?
Square Enix wise, I'm definitely excited for Nioh, as I was saying, the Nioh announcement. Which I'm sure most people are going to refer to as Neo 2 until they actually come up with a official name, which the end part of the little trailer thing they showed made it seem like they weren't set on what they were calling it yet. Because it said, like, Neo and then had tons of jobbly text going on beside it, so that kind of seems to indicate they haven't decided what they're calling it yet. I'm really excited about that. Because Platinum Games is going to be making it, and I told you this off the stream, but obviously I'm going to say it again because in stream now. But one of the things I thought was horrible about DragonGuard 3 was because they lost the company that made all the previous titles because they got bought out, and then the company that bought them out went bankrupt, so they went under. And Square Enix basically got the Unreal Engine again and just basically said, here's a playground and throw your action figures in it. And it just, the gameplay portion of Dragon God 3 came out. It wasn't optimized right. It required a 5 gig hard drive install, and it still had insanely long load times and things, so it was just perplexing on what the hell the people who were actually making the gameplay portion. The story was still enjoyable, but the gameplay was very flawed in all the wrong ways. So I'm really excited with Platinum's games working on Nioh 2, because they have a lot of experience, so I have a lot of faith in that. Hopefully it won't turn horrible. I am heavily confused on how the hell there is a sequel, though. And do you have any interest in Nioh, or have you already know everything in Nioh?
Yeah, I'm definitely interested in the game because I've wanted to get into the Dragon Guard games, and I've wanted to pick up the original Nier game, but I just never gotten around to it because I don't want to pay like $20.
Then I can't talk about why then, because it's a heavy ass spoilers on why. I mean, I'm excited about, but there's something about the ending that makes it, well, like, I don't know how it technically is having a sequel. So I'm also very curious story wise on what the hell is going on, but I would have to spoil the game. So I, if you're
Is
interested
it
in
maybe a
it.
remake?
No, it's definitely not a remake, because none of the characters are recognizable in any of the games. So, right now there's always speculation on who the characters are. But again, that would possibly go spoilers too, so I'll leave it at that. So, because like, I would never want to ruin Nioh for somebody who's interested in it. It's like the best thing to fucking experience in the game is it's just really sad and depressing storyline. And I don't know how much it goes for right now, but I
I think it's
mean,
around $17.99, I think, or maybe a little bit more at GameStop pre-owned. I mean, I'm not sure. I've been trying to find it, like at yard sales or and stuff, or cheap on Craigslist, but I've just never found one that was in the price range that I wanted to pay for it.
how much do you want to pay for it?
I want to find it in the $10 to $15 range, but.
Well, maybe you can
And
pick
I
it
don't
up on
want the
a.
360 version.
Oh, you want the 360 version?
No, I don't want
Oh,
that
you
version, which
don't
is
want.
because GameStop, I think, has that version, and it's cheaper than the PS3 version. But I want the PS3 version just since the Dragon Guard stuff is all on the PlayStation, so.
Yeah.
Yeah, one thing I was surprised about at E3 is that Microsoft and Sony did not announce a new slim model system. And Sony still has hard drive problems because they still max out at 2 terabytes, and there's no way to get any more than that.
Oh, I do remember them saying something about having a terabyte hard drive being officially released by Sony for the PS4, which I'm kind of hoping that won't be expensive, because I used up like shitloads of my hard drive on videos. Like, the 500 gigabyte thing is just not enough for all the patches and downloads.
Wait, you want to buy a new system for that? Because you
No,
know you can. Oh,
not a
okay.
new
Because you.
system. They said they're gonna have a terabyte hard drive that you can buy. But yeah, I know
Oh.
you can get third-party stuff too. But Sony's gonna have an official one, so I'm gonna see how much it costs. If it's not super expensive, that's probably what I'll go with.
Because I believe you can get a 2 terabyte hybrid drive, which actually makes the load times a little better.
I'm not
Obviously,
concerned
those are
about
third-party
load
drives.
times. I just want freaking space, because GTA 5's like at 60, 70 gigs or something. It's Maybe it was more like 50. I don't remember. It's just getting overly bigger and bigger, and most of the games have like a 10 gig patch. Like, then I got all the videos I have. It's just,
yeah. If Sony doesn't announce a new way of using external hard drives or another way aside from using the Nyko expansion thing that allows you to use bigger hard drives. If they don't have some kind of way to have more than 2 terabytes, I'm probably going to get all third-party stuff on the Xbox One, since the Xbox One, I think, goes up to 12 or 15 terabytes. It can support up to that much. Nice. So.
Yeah, and if I remember correctly, at E3, Microsoft announced that they were going to have a new Xbox One that comes with a terabyte hard drive for the price of a PS4.
Yeah, I think that was right before E3. Like, it was like about a week ago, I think.
So hopefully if there's a Black Friday deal on that, that's probably what I'll go with. Because, I mean, if the patches and shit are anything like on the PS4, I'm going to need the space.
Yeah, it's about the same as the PlayStation 4. So everything, I think, takes the same.
I don't know if I should be happy or sad that whale collection thing will probably be the first Xbox One game I'll get, unless I get a version of it that comes with a game.
Yeah. You're not interested in the Sunset Overdrive, even? Just something that was already released?
It's Sunset Overdrive's probably, that and Dead Rising 3 are like the only games I'm interested on the Xbox One. I'm not even that hyped about Dead Rising 3, because they did not release the DLC on disc when they had the opportunity. When they did that, they did just re-released it with DLC codes. I hear the patch is ridiculously huge, which is sad, and I've heard a lot of different criticism of the kind of direction they steered Dead Rising 3 in, so I'm not being very positive about it, but, you know, until I play it, I can't really say a whole lot. But I'll still get it, I just probably won't be as happy as I could be with it. Sunset Overdrive, though, looks awesome, though, so that's definitely another game I'll get with it. But it's not awesome enough that I'm going to go buy the system brand new.
Yeah. I've enjoyed Sunset Overdrive. I finished the game, and it was enjoyable. It's a little easy, but other than that, it's fun.
Well, I'm glad to hear you enjoyed it. Recommendations, happy to hear.
Yeah, all I have left to do, I think, is the just like some extra like a little mission, like time attack kind of stuff, like little quests. Other than that, I've pretty much 100% finished the game, so.
Damn.
I haven't bought any of the DLC, though. And there's a decent amount of DLC. Which I was hoping they were going to release a complete on-disc version of, a version of the game that had all the DLC on disc, but they never got it. They didn't do that yet, so maybe around the holidays this year they'll release a version of it that has all DLC on disc, or do the Dead Rising thing and just put it in the box.
I'd rather it be on disc myself, but I guess it's about nothing at the same time, too. Yeah, there wasn't a lot of stuff that wowed me besides the whale collection for Microsoft, so. I mean, there was the announcement of the 360 backwards playability, and I'm a little skeptical on that. I don't know if they talked in detail about how it works.
But it works pretty well. I've seen it all. I've used it already.
See, I'm concerned if it's anything like the 360's backwards capabilities. Because the original Xbox titles were, they basically made a separate emulator for each game to function on the 360. So, I mean, if it's something like that, I'm not seeing it going very well. Because, I mean, there were a lot of games that had issues, and They didn't even make a crap load of titles work on the 360. Like, I heard the same thing. Like, we're gonna make like tons of the games work. We're gonna get a huge chunk of the library and so on and so on. And every year it just became more of a thing that pushed behind the curtain more and more every year until nobody really talked about it anymore.
Yeah, I hope they do get support for a lot of the 360 games, but
Yeah. I
from
mean,
what I've
I hope
played,
it's
it's
good.
pretty
I
good.
mean, don't get me wrong, I'm not trying to shit on it. I'm slightly concerned about it.
Yeah.
I mean, if it works out well and stuff, that's awesome then, 'cause that's convenience.
Yeah, I mean, I still am gonna keep my 360 just for having,
Oh
the
yeah.
original. But it's nice to have.
I mean, it's nice
I wish the
to,
PlayStation would do it.
oh yeah, it was really sad to hear the Xbox One, PS4 weren't gonna have it when they launched. So, I mean, Nintendo was the only one saying they were keeping backwards capabilities, and of course, it's if it all works out well, then yeah, that's a good move on Microsoft, and that I just hope they keep their promise and it functions right. Because I mean, I hold all the similar promises on the 360 and only saw less and less support for it. I mean, like, Psychonauts was playable on the 360, but it had all kinds of weird graphical errors, like trippy color problems and stuff with the textures and stuff. It was really odd.
Did they allow you to play online games on the 360 when that first happened? Like when that
I
they had the
think
backwards
the
compatibility?
Halo games were the only ones that worked.
Because I know they are doing like any game, I believe any game that has online capabilities for the 360 backwards compatibility, they are going to allow you to still play online.
Yeah, I heard about that, and that's also a really good move. I also heard you can stream them, any of the games that can be played on it, and that's also a
Oh,
really
you
smart
can?
move. That's what I've heard. I heard you're
I know you
supposed.
could take screenshots, but I didn't know you could do that.
I heard suppo I don't know if it's true for sure, but I, from what I heard and read, it sounded like you could stream them too. So that's a good move too.
Yeah. That's pretty nice, actually. So we don't have to get like a capture card for the 360 or anything.
Yeah. I mean, it's definitely nice in my opinion. It now, as long as it doesn't have the issues of the 360's backwards capabilities, it'll be all good then. It'd be cool. But that's mainly my concern there is just the promises of the past make me iffy about the promises of the future, if you get what I mean.
Yeah.
But
I think Microsoft has changed since then.
oh yeah, I mean since the Xbox One launch, yeah, it like what's the new guy who's in charge? Phil Spencer, I think his
Yeah.
name was. Yeah,
Yeah.
he been doing a hell of a job trying to fucking get that thing back on track from the previous guy. Like that previous guy, that guy, oh, he should never fucking walk in games again, like. I have no fucking idea what the hell he was thinking. Hey guys, let's make like 90% of the thing about television and sports and fucking, talk about DRM, how you have to have mandatory installs and shit. It's like, what could possibly go wrong in that? It's like, I don't know what the fuck you were thinking.
From a money-making perspective, that was probably a good thing, but not for us.
But you think corporations would probably realize that what's really good for them probably doesn't ring really good towards us.
Yeah.
But I don't know. It's like I just, and then you had that one guy who was fucking like being a white knight asshole on Twitter. I don't remember his name, where he was getting into arguments with everyone who had an issue with the
Oh,
DRM
yeah.
online and Shay's like, what was it? Deal with it.
Yeah.
Just deal with it. It's like, my vacuum cleaner needs electricity, but I don't have electricity, so I'm not gonna pay for electricity and shit. I mean, that guy got fired for that shit too. And now he's became an eternal meme. You ever see that that piece of artwork where he's wearing a McDonald's uniform with a spatula saying "Deal with it"?
No, I know he has a lot of memes, but I didn't know about that one.
He became his own little meme for all that shit. But yeah, that was a horrible PR thing there and horrible presentation. Like, it's like, I don't know what the fuck they were thinking. Like, hey, game console, let's not talk about fucking video games. But yeah, Phil Spencer, do an awesome job doing what the fuck they should have been doing since the beginning. Games, games, and more games. I hope they never even mentioned the Kinect during the E3 thing, too.
Yeah, they didn't.
Which
is a little surprising, but...
Well, a lot of people think they were going to stuff it under the rug of, shh, no talk, no tell.
Well, I know that there's going to be the Windows 10 update, which is going to include Cortana, so I assume you're going to need a Kinect for Cortana.
In order to speak to her. The Cortana's on my TV, waifu!
Yep.
Now everyone's Xbox One, so pre-installed with waifus. Power to the Halo. Well, I actually don't know anything about any of that, but I am sure the waifu jokes will be coming as soon as it happens. I'm predicting them.
Yeah, probably.
But,
anyways, anything else you want to talk about from E3? Because I'm gonna have to go pretty soon.
Oh, well, if you need to go, you can go.
Yeah, but anything else you wanted to cover real quick?
Well, there was the Fallout 4, Doom. Let's see, World of Final Fantasy that they showed off.
I actually think that looks fun.
I'd like to know more about what the hell is going on, but it could be interesting.
I feel like I'm the only one that actually thought that looked good.
Artistically, I think it's a little odd mismatch with Kingdom Hearts art style and then swapping between Chibi. But, if it's a fun game, it's a fun game,
Yeah. I also think it's kind of dumb that Sony didn't mention the Vita whatsoever. I mean, I know Final Fantasy Worlds, I believe, at the end of the trailer said PS4 and Vita. But yeah, other than that, there was no Vita stuff.
Well, I believe I said it in my video about where all the journalists were going, Vita's dead because Sony said it's a legacy product, it's dead! I don't think Sony themselves are gonna really do anything on the Vita. I think they're pretty much done making anything on it. I think it's just they're leaving it to the little makers to make stuff for it. I mean, they might make something here and there, but overall, I don't expect them to be focusing on it very much, if at all. But I certainly don't think the Vita's dead. I think there's plenty of other companies making physical copies of games, nonetheless, in America for the Vita, so.
Yeah, it's pretty sad because I actually like the Vita a lot.
Let's see, anything happened at E3 on Kingdom Hearts or Final Fantasy VII? There was a Final Fantasy VII remake announced, like a actual remake. Kingdom Hearts, didn't they just show mainly a bunch of mobile games and then show the trailer for Kingdom Hearts 3?
Yeah, they showed the trailer for Kingdom Hearts 3, and I believe it's still in development, so I guess...
Yeah.
That's not good that we didn't even get, like, a release year, I don't believe, like, no 2016 or anything, so...
It's probably in development hell. Like, when they said they were going to use the Unreal Engine for it, I just was like, development hell.
Yeah, it looks nice. I really do hope it comes out. I'm not the biggest Kingdom Hearts fan, but It looks good.
Vita is going very cross buy heavy. Yeah, the Vita and the PS3 were very had a lot of cross deals, and they'll probably continue doing that as long as they'll games for both. They'll probably continue doing that.
One thing I want to mention before I go, just because I saw on Twitter that you might be interested, is did you hear about, it just happened, I think they just talked about it today, that Digimon, the Cyber, I'm not even sure how you pronounce that last name, Sleuth, Cyber Sleuth or whatever, it might be getting a PS4 release, and there was a listing on Amazon Canada and Amazon Spain, I believe. So we might be getting that game, but not on the Vita, which is kind of disappointing, I guess, because I did want it on the Vita as well, but it's cool, we're getting that game, we might be getting that game on the PS4.
Well, if somebody, we get it for the PS4, I could totally go down with that.
I know, the game looked really great from the gameplay I had seen on the
That's the
on
PG one, right?
Yeah.
Yeah. I could
that
totally
game looks really good.
Yeah, I could totally live with that being on the PS4. I could go with that. As long as it's physical, though. Give me a damn physical!
Well, if it was listed on Amazon, it probably is. But somebody at E3, I guess, asked someone from Bandai Namco about any information on it, and he said he had nothing to say about it. But there was a listing, so we're probably going to get it. But it does. It is disappointing that they didn't. If they do bring it over, it might not be on the Vita, because I did want it on the Vita as well. Even just getting Vita and PS4.
Sadly, being in a different country from the original publishing team's company, that kind of thing happens, sadly, sometimes, to be cost efficient. I mean, look at the, what is it, that Dynasty Warriors Dragon Quest game called again? The Dragon Quest game that's basically, it's a spin-off.
Not the Dragon Quest Heroes?
Yeah, that.
Was it Heroes?
I mean, in Japan it's on the PS4 and PS3, but we're not getting the PS3 version, and I'm pretty sure they're just doing that to save money and stuff. I think it's once a physical snaps on Wubble Gloves. What? Yeah. Keep your Wubble Gloves yourself. Here's a big question. Anything on Persona 5? I haven't personally heard anything about Persona 5, did you?
No, there was just that trailer, they have a new trailer, but it was just that one that was in Japan. Just, I guess, with English subtitles, but there's still no English in the game, so it's basically, like, still not close to being finished or localized, but...
And fans probably always had it fan-subbed.
Maybe.
I wouldn't be surprised.
Yeah, I don't know why they even bother giving us those trailers.
Eh. People who don't go on the internet, I guess. Like, we're too old for your fancy-ass internet. My day, we went to conferences all day to watch our video games.
There was a new trailer for Persona 4 Dancing All Night. I didn't watch that one, but I assume it's something we've already seen. From Japan's trailers.
I do remember a few weeks ago there was some new footage thing they at was released on YouTube, so it might have been there, not sure, but I am very excited about Dancing All Night. I'm hoping it'll be very fun and enjoyable.
Yeah. You're gonna get the limited edition?
Oh yeah, I pre-ordered the limited edition.
I still need to do that. After seeing Persona Q's limited edition price drop so low, I'm kind of wondering if I should just wait.
Oh, did it?
Yeah, it's only like, I think it's a little above 50 on Amazon. Just like 53 or 57 or something.
They must have made a lot of copies. They must have been expecting a lot of pre-orders.
Yeah, I was thinking it was going to be like the gold edition of the... of Persona 4, which I regret not buying.
Oh, I know. I didn't have a Vita at that time, so I was like, I was iffy on whether I wanted to get it or not, and I was like, man, I should have got that.
I know.
But, it took me a while to debate whether I wanted to get the limited edition for Dancing All Night or not. Because, I mean,
the soundtracks are enough for me.
Overall, it seems like you're really just paying mostly for the DLC, kinda. I mean, the pouch is really nice. I'm not expecting the little Teddy keychain thing to be really nice. I mean, if it is nice, it'd be nice, but I'm going to assume it's probably going to be really small in that.
Is it a phone strap or is it an actual keychain?
It doesn't show a good image of it. I've only seen the advertisement image that just shows the Teddy portion. It doesn't have any full screen thing of it, so. And then the skins. Let's see, the skins and something else are supposed to come with the normal version.
I don't like the skins. I don't like putting anything on there on the Vita.
But, yeah, I was just kind of...
The pouch looks nice.
Yeah. I was just kind of like, I don't know, but I was like, I know the persona person in me is just like, get the fucking box away!
Yeah.
But,
I feel the same way.
I really wish there was some way to get, like, the faceplates for the Persona Q 3DS XL, though.
Yeah, I actually just sold mine. Just because it was sitting, and now that I have my new 3DS.
Yeah, and that was another thing. You know, the new 3DS was it out yet, or just only announced? I don't remember, but...
It wasn't... Yeah, it was just announced before they released the limited edition.
So it was like,
I figured I was going to sell it, but...
Yeah. So it was like, why even have it be the normal 3DS when now there's a whole new 3DS? And none of the faceplates or anything are swappable, that, and it's just...
They probably just took the faceplates that they already had from Japan and probably just put them on some, you know, US models of the 3DS XL.
Well, we have millions of these faceplates that ain't selling in Japan. Quick, just slap them on some XLs and make a limited edition in America. They'll never know the difference.
Yeah, it was games exclusive, so I assume there wasn't a ton of them, and it was considered limited edition, obviously, so that's what it seems like, that's what they did, so.
But, yeah, I'm looking forward to Dancing All Night. It is a shame there wasn't more information on Persona 5, even though they, as far as I understood, they clarified it's still dated for this year.
Persona 5 is?
Yeah, I heard somebody said that Atlus did clarify it's still dated for this year.
Oh yeah, I heard about that too. Yeah, I don't know how that is.
Yeah, I mean, we still haven't seen crap, like, we've seen some gameplay, but just small snippets in between story stuff, so... You would think they'd have a lot more gameplay of it at this time if it was still dated for this year. I mean, you would think it was getting close.
Yeah. I really want them to show another trailer and hopefully maybe even another character. And I don't want too many spoilers, but I would at least like to see one more character.
I don't know. I mean, it's seeming like they're focusing a lot on those four characters.
I feel like those new characters are a little bit more generic compared to the past characters. Mostly from the fact that both of them are blonde. And the female, for some reason, reminds me of Junko from, from Danganronpa.
The ultimate despair. She's your ultimate despair, right?
Yeah.
And you know, actually, I wonder if they had a booth or anything at E3, because I'm definitely looking forward to the next game in that
The
series.
NIS?
Yeah.
I don't know. Maybe.
Because I'm definitely looking
I haven't heard
forward to the
anything
next
about it.
game.
I heard the next game, or this next game, at least in Japan, or people who have imported it, didn't think it was that great, but doesn't
Eh.
look bad to me.
Looks all right to me, and I'm just gonna enjoy it for the story anyway. Yeah, I mean, mainly the thing is, as a very senior person in games, you know, something I've always seen, like, forever is with a popular franchise does a spin-off that doesn't use the same kind of gameplay. Like, I always see everyone just like, oh, it's awful, because it's, you know, even though it's a spin-off and that, it's like, oh, it's awful. Like,
Yeah.
to me, spin-offs all space for them to try out different things. But, I don't know, it's just something I always see. Like, I remember with Kingdom Hearts Chain of Memories, everyone was like running down the streets and like, it's awful! It's awful!
Yeah. I don't
But
know, I like the Persona spinoffs, like the fighting games, and Q was good.
I've heard people say those are awful too, because it's like, oh, it's not an RPG, it's clearly awful. Like, I just like, I don't know why people, like, I understand if it's a main entry in the series, then yeah, that's kind of weird. But, you know, when it's a spin-off, it's like, I don't see why people freak out so much about being, it's a fighting game, it's this, it's an action or something else. It's like, why do you have to be freaking out about the game having a spin-off that's a different type of gameplay? I just don't know why you have to automatically consider it shit. And the Persona fighting games are really fun, in my opinion.
Yeah, they are. They're actually some of my favorite, 2D fighting games, I think. Even over Blaze Blue and even Guilty Gear. I
The
think they're
kind
more
of
fun
thing
than anything
they
else.
Did with the Personas really reminds me of one of the JoJo Bizarre Adventure fighting games. A bit how they did it.
The new one or the older ones?
I think it was the PS1 game.
Yeah, because I was going to
I
say, the
can't
new one's a
remember.
3D game.
I can't remember which entry it was, but I remember one of the JoJo Bizarre Adventures, you'd have a summon thing that you can control during combat with your character in that. While you don't directly control the persona itself, it is its own entity in the battlefield when it appears and you can hit it, which breaks one of the cards. So it was kind of a really interesting system to me, but I still need to play the sequel storyline. I'm kind of debating on when I want to do that, because I got so many things I want to do. Just always so many things I want to do.
Yeah. Well, I'm gonna go now. I need to go eat. It's been a while. All
Okay, you take it easy, man.
right, bye.
Bye. So, on my end, I really enjoyed the Sony press conference. If I had to say, I enjoyed any of them a lot. Because, I mean, the Fallout 4 announcement, while cool, it wasn't anything that made me fall out of my seat. And while Dark Souls 3 was announced during the Microsoft one, that's multi-plat, so that again is not anything to fall out of seat. But it just kind of like, there was a lot more things that interest me in the Sony one, because of the Shenmue 3 announcement, definitely something that got me very happy of that. And the Final Fantasy VII remake, mainly I've been very critical of it, but I'm hoping for the best with it. But overall, though, and then the Last Guardian, of course, too. Like, I'm really, really happy to hear that the Last Guardian did not end up in development hell. 'Cause they let the trademark drop, and that made everyone think they basically were silently letting it die. But so now it's supposed to be exclusive for the PS4, and that could work a lot in its benefit because better system hardware on that to take advantage of, and they had gameplay. They had functioning gameplay, as opposed to little segments that they did for the PS3 version. So, and they said it'll be for next year. Now, admittedly, they've promised The Last Guardian several hundred times to us on the PS3, so obviously taking it with a grain of salt. But I considering they showed just full out gameplay, I think there's a good chance that this probably not going to be that big of an issue this time, but who knows? I'm hoping for the best. Nothing out here is destroyed. Sadly, I didn't get to watch the Nintendo one. Wow, he's fat walling. Yeah, he didn't stand a chance. But I gotta say, E3 is, aside from Shenmue 3, The Last Guardian, let's see, Nioh 2 and The Last Guardian are probably the biggest, newest games I'm way excited for. Shenmue 3 I'm excited for, of course, because it's fucking Shenmue. Like, anyone who was a Dreamcast Sega fan, it's hard to say you've never played Shenmue. So I'm really excited about that. Go check out its Kickstarter. It's always funded and everything. It'll be on PS4 and PC. And Dark Souls 3, I might make a video just about Dark Souls 3 in its own entirety because I'm excited for it, but at the same time, I'm curious on what they're doing with it, because I don't know. I haven't heard if Miyazaki is going to be behind it or not. And there was a my next update video was recorded when the leak thing happened with the pictures. So I was kind of speculating that if they did make a Dark Souls 3, that Miyazaki was probably not going to be ahead of it, and they were just going to assign someone, probably the guy who did 2, to continue doing Dark Souls and kind of probably end up milking that train with Bandai Namco. But I'm really curious to know if Miyazaki is going to have a head control of it or not. Because, I mean, I did miss his presence in Dark Souls 2. Like, it wasn't awful, but you can know there were some significant changes. Some more interesting ideas, and other ones seemed more harmful. So, but either way, I am excited for Dark Souls 3. It's kind of hard to say I'm not excited for a new Souls entry. I know a lot of people recently have been saying they feel like the Souls games are coming like Call of Duty, and I totally disagree, and it is my opinion. It is an opinion, but I do disagree on the factor that, for one thing, Souls games are way longer than COD games. You're lucky to get fucking 5 hours out of the story mode. And on top of that, vastly different settings. I mean, admittedly, 2 is probably the most cop-out, and basically, if 3 becomes more of a cop-out than 2, then I will be thinking it. I never played Dark Souls 1 or 2, but lots of people say it's crap. Like, the Souls games in general, crap? Demon Souls, Dark Souls, and Bloodborne are really good, in my opinion. Dark Souls 2 is a mixed bag, though. I really feel like Miyazaki not being behind it really affected it a lot. It had a few good ideas, but, like, one of the things I'm really critical with Dark Souls 2 is it had so many humanoid enemies and very little weird shit. There was so. Number 2. Yeah, a lot of Souls fans are very critical with 2. There was people in my band camp that say there's way too many humanoid enemies. There was the other band camps of, like, people picking on different elements of the combat and that. Hell, there's people who just simply hate the fact that they took the wall. The doll, the dead body physics out of the game. And that was because of a spell. I would say Dark Souls 2 was the easiest entry. Like, to me, Dark Souls 2 was, like, the easiest out of all of them. Like, it handed you, it really held your hand a lot more, and it didn't punish you as much. You weren't punished for accidentally killing or deciding to kill someone. You could resurrect them as a ghost and still do business with them and shit. PvP stuff was kind of messed up. The blue sentinels were just fucking worthless. Like, I think there's only 2 times I ever met a blue sentinel, and I've never personally really experienced the blue sentinels working for me. So that whole covenant was pretty worthless. And it had some good ideas, but it kind of did waver on the mediocre side more. It was still enjoyable. It was still enjoyable, but if Dark Souls 3 doesn't go back up and continues going downward in the direction that Dark Souls 2 was going in, I will basically say that Dark Souls needs to die and they need to just go on to a different setting. Difficulty? Bloodborne. I think Bloodborne would be second to Demon Souls. I think Demon Souls is still the hardest of all of them. But Bloodborne also has a different mindset behind it, so it's kind of an interesting scenario. But I'd probably say it's second hardest. Because it doesn't feature so much defensive play, I feel like until you get much further in the game, it's not as batshit hard. Because it encourages you to be a lot more violent. But at the same time, a lot of shit later on in the game, if you stay low level like I was doing so far in my Let's Play, it does get fucking challenging though later on. It gets pretty hard later on if you don't start leveling up a whole lot. So I would say it's easier than I would say Dark Souls 1's easier than Bloodborne. Bloodborne's harder than Dark Souls 1, and Demon Souls is the hardest of all of them. Demon Souls is hard because it doesn't hold your hand at all. Like, Demon Souls gives you no fucking mercy at all. You kill Stockpile Thomas. Hell, you aggro Stockpile Thomas. Your entire storage system's fucked until you beat the game. You kill or aggro one of the healing, like, mages and shit. Like, you're fucked until you beat the game. There's no way to ever de-aggro them or bring them back or anything. It is punishing for the simplest of mistakes. Dark Souls 1 allowed you to clean up your sin and de-aggro people as long as you didn't kill them and shit. So, it was a little less merciless. But with Dark Souls 2, like I said, you have the option of summoning the ghosts at Tombstone for souls. So, even if you killed someone, there's only a few negatives to permanently killing someone. Respawn instantly. Until you hit a load screen or rest at a lamp or something, you shouldn't be seeing enemies respawn. I've never seen anything respawn unless I hit a load screen or something. From what I heard, the doll and the old man in the wheelchair can't be permanently killed. They just come back to life or something when you come back, is what I heard with them. So there's no, yeah, like if you killed the, you know, actually that's actually what's probably the most ironic thing in Dark Souls 2 is you can kill the Emerald Maiden, but you can't summon her soul to continue leveling up. So that's like the only real punishment you get killing NPCs in Dark Souls 2. Oh, you're talking about once the Blood Moon. You're talking about the blood enemies. They're designed that way. That has to do with the story somewhat. But that whole segment is putting you to the test of basically efficiently killing shit and getting your fucking ass moving. Basically what the game's saying is, if you can't kill everything, the difficulty spikes there if you're low level, man. Oh boy. It's like, those stairwells with the fucking Cthulhu shit shooting beams and shit. Oh boy. Oh boy. And then the three hunters down in the cathedral area. Man, talk about no fucking mercy. That's probably one of the instances of the game beating the living fuck out of you. Yeah, Bloodborne, if you play Dark Souls 2 and then play Bloodborne, you can see the difference of what Miyazaki brings to the game. Oh, really? I did, what level was I? I was probably like late 30s, early 40s? Now I'm in, like, the 60s now. But, yeah, you gotta kill them fast and kill the Bell Maiden. Or you could rush through them. I mean, there's different ways you could do it. Or you could also try sniping the Bell Maidens. Because they affect the, when they die, any of the enemies that are connected to him get stunned, and you can also use that opportunity. I'm a noob. I'm not trying to say you suck. I'm just saying. I have three Souls games under my belt. I'm a little more used to it. I still get killed too, don't. I mean, I've died a handful of times though too. I mean, I'm not trying to say, oh, I win one shot at everything, all the way to the boss. Yep. I think I died about 4 or 5 times to the boss in the Unseen Village. It was a pretty interesting spot. It definitely took me forever to kill the lightning boss thing that's there too. You don't have to try to say it. I did it. My soul level? I should be level 8. Yeah, I'm level 8. I just said, I'm level 8. Unless you're asking what SL means. SL means soul level, if that's what you're asking. But, soul level 8. When I first found Poyle, the Poyle Beast, very hard. When I went to refight it after being much further in the game, it was vastly easy. Especially since when I invited Pixie, we killed it in Pixie's world and found out the trick to it, and then we murdered it in my world on and I recorded that. Oh, well, in this I'm level 8, but I'm like halfway. Like, this tune's like halfway done in Demon Souls. Like, I got shit I shouldn't really have that easily. Like, that's why, see this top hat I'm wearing? I'm wearing, like, anyone who's actually beat Demon Souls, the fuck were disconnected. What a chicken. What a chicken shit. But, yeah, this top hat's from near the end of the castle area. Like, I have stuff I shouldn't really have. Like, I'm not saying you can't, it's just. I mean, one of the things I'm using is a dragon longsword, which normally isn't super useful, but since I'm so low level, it's actually very useful. And I'm not wearing anything particularly interesting except for the hat. Like I said, I kind of wear it so people are like, oh shit, this guy's been like further in the game. It's kind of a doom warning. But yeah, this tune has like about half the game finished too. So very low level, but fucking, has shit done, but can't. Since they're so low level, they can't do a whole lot because they need more stats to use most shit, so it's kind of up and down. I'm pretty sure I have like all the NPCs at the Nexus. I have the Prince there, I have Patches there, I have the fat dude who is locked in the prison over there, backwards. Got him out, so I got. And I have the Beast Talisman. Yeah, see the Talismans of the Beast. I did all that crap. Though, I killed the Dark Phantom of the dude at the mine. I didn't do the assassination stuff. Okay, you take it easy. Well, we pretty much talked about all the E3 stuff. I think that pretty much covered most of everything I wanted to talk about. I'd say Sony was probably the better of the E3 stuff, and Microsoft was kind of disappointing to me. I mean, the whale thing was probably the only thing I was really excited for on their side. I don't usually get too thrilled, but The Last Guardian, Shenmue 3, Dark Souls 3, and definitely very excited about Nioh 2. That's probably the most exciting announcement, and it I would have loved it to have gameplay, but just it's just I'm just happy to hear that the Cradle of the Drakengard stuff is still getting to do stuff, so. Hopefully something will get some gameplay or something, but I'm very positive with Platinum Games working on it, so hopefully positive stuff will be coming from that. But yeah, I think that's pretty much it for the E3 stuff, unless anyone got any questions or anything they want to ask me about? I mean, I guess I could ramble on a little bit more about the Doom. Didn't talk about Doom. I did get to see the Doom thing. But yeah, if anyone has any questions or anything, shoot 'em at me. This is a good time for it. I did get to see the Doom footage, and what was funny is on Twitter, I was like, I wonder how long it'll take SJWs to be triggered by this. And like 3 minutes later, Anita Sarkeesian and John McIntosh all way on Twitter saying all the spewed bullshit. But I like the Doom 3. I've played Doom 1, Doom 3, and I think I played a little of Doom 2 before too. But Doom 3 is the only one I ever beat. And I liked the Doom 3 because I like survival horror games, and it was very designed a much more survival horror style, and I can see why Doom fans didn't like it because that's not how Doom is. So, from what I saw, I would say it's probably very faithful to the original Doom games, in that it's more fast paced than what Doom 3 was. There's no darkness and flashlights and stuff, so I could see why original Doom fans were probably really excited about it. Graphically, it looked okay. Wasn't a lot of enemies on screen. I remember in Doom 1, there'd be all kinds of moments where there would be shitloads of, like, you'd open a door, go down an elevator shaft, and then all of a sudden, there was like a half dozen enemies about to fucking kill you and shit. Oh, damn it. Where are the people? Did I win everyone off? I think I ran everyone off. Might have to go to Stone. Oh, there we go. I was gonna say I might have to try Stonefang. But overall, it was just, eh. It's E3.